ocean was whiskey and I was a duck. I'd dive to the bottom, I'd never come up. Rye whiskey, rye whiskey, rye whiskey, I cry. If I don't get rye whiskey, I surely will die. When I'm hungry, drink when I'm dry. If I get to feeling much better, I'll sprout wings and fly. Rye whiskey, rye whiskey, rye whiskey, I cry. If I don't get rye whiskey, I surely will die.
My name is Francis L. Haynie, and I was born at Walnut Point in 1929, February 2nd, and the ground was covered with snow. It was a cold day.
You remember that?
Yeah. It was a cold day. And then I went to Heathfield School for 2 years. Then I went from there to Reedville School for 2 years and came back to Heathfield School, still in the grades. And I got far as the seventh grade, then I had to quit school and go to work. And I worked at Walnut Point for James Lewis. Everything went on down there, I did it. For $32.50 a week. So many kids nowadays said they wouldn't work an hour for that.
Did you have any brothers and sisters?
I had a brother and, I mean, two brothers and one sister. And I'm the only one left out of the family.
How did you, when you were going to Reedville School, were you living, did you move down to Reedville or did you?
Yeah, my dad and mother lived down at Reedville.
Oh, I see.
And down there by the other side of Slaughter's Beach. And we used to have to walk from the house clap to Rosser Williams' store and get on the school bus. Then we'd ride the school bus from there over to the school.
Where was Williams' store?
And right down to Bytho.
The Bytho.
Uh-huh. Yeah, where the store is now. I don't know where.
That's the same old store, I think it is.
It was. Okay.
Didn't you have a brother named Bootsy?
Yeah, Bootsy.
Was he a boat builder?
No, indeed. He wasn't a boat builder. He worked on engines and all that kind of stuff. Then I had another brother who was a whole lot younger. He was born when I was almost 16 years old. And his name was Johnny. And he got killed in an automobile accident down on Fleeton Road. And him and Gene Swan and Oscar Ray Vallandigham. And I done my best to talk to him, said, leave the whiskey alone when you're on the road. But it was the 4th of day, July.
What year can you recall that happened?
Huh?
What year was that happened?
When he passed away?
Yes, sir.
I think it was 73.
Okay. One of the questions we've been asking people lately is what were impressions of this area during the Depression, you know?
Well, I don't remember much about that.
Yeah.
But I do remember my daddy shucking horses and delivering them at Reedville at 25 cents a quart. And of course, he always got a jaw back. They give him an extra jaw and stuff like that.
Do you remember your uncle's car at Raymond?
Yeah, I was in service. And when Collie died, he dropped dead down at the fish factory, what I understand. And I had a devil to get a leave from the service to come home and go to the funeral.
Yeah.
And I got that through the Red Cross.
So you were in the service in the Army?
Army.
Yeah.
Transportation Corps. And I was stationed at Fort Eustis.
Yes.
And I had a little over a year to go. And I got my orders to ship to Korea, and I was a cooking service. Then I came home that weekend, and my mother had, she knew I loved fried chicken, so she killed a fried chicken and fried it up, and I just didn't want nothing to eat that weekend. It didn't feel too sharp. And I went back, and one of my buddies was on the shift that I had been relieved from. I filled his place because he was running late getting there, and I took sick with appendicitis. And it sent me over to the hospital. I guess it was about a half a mile from the mess hall we were working in, over to the Army hospital, and operated on me. And my commanding officer came over in the next 2 days and told me, says, "Haynie, you're a lucky man." I said, "What's that?" "You got cut here, but you'll have to get shot over there. Your orders has been canceled." So I felt good about that part.
Yeah, yeah. How long were you in the Army?
2 years.
2 years of two-year.
And couldn't make nothing but PFC. The rank was frozen. Mm-hmm. Nobody could make anything.
Yeah, yeah.
And but I acted sergeant because I went as assistant mess sergeant and stuff. And I would get paid for it, and I wouldn't sign it. Take the money, and in 2-3 days, I go down to the finance office, said, "This money is legally yours." Then I'd take it. Because
yeah.
If I had to pay it back, no more than I would get, I never would pay it back.
Yeah, yeah. So you were in the Army for 2 years, and what did you do right after you got out?
Right after I got out, I was lost. Because mm-hmm. A lot of the boys that I grew up with was married, gone. Some was dead, some is in service. And then I got a notice report down to Norfolk. They want me to sign up for 3 more years or whatever. I didn't sign up, only drafted the first time. Mm-hmm. And so I went down there and they offered me staff sergeant. And if I sign up. And I got to thinking about that thing. Said, "Well, you don't have to make a decision. Just call this number or send this blank back signed." I come home and got thinking about it, and then later, coming December, we got married, my wife and myself. But I'm ahead of myself on that. I went to the, came back home, and Virgil Henderson was a fish boat captain. And he come up to see me about going fishing. He said, "About cooking on the steamer." And I said, "Well, okay, I'll take a shot at it." So I went, and we done very good, got around part of the world that I had never been to, mm-hmm. all up South Portland, Maine, and Gloucester, Massachusetts, yeah. and stuff. Okay. And we'd done real good.
Yeah.
And came on back, and the next, of course, I got married that coming December after that summer was over. And then he wanted me to go on another boat he had gotten, and I told him, nope, that was it. I stayed home, and then started crabbing, hull seining, and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you've been here ever since?
Been right here, born right across the creek from here, yeah. over on Warner Point side.
Mm-hmm. And when did you get into the boat building?
Well, I started building little models and stuff when I was between 8 and 9 years old. Cutting them out of red cedar, making decoys. And when I went in service, I had, I guess, 10 or 15 wooden decoys, no paint, nothing on them, just plain red cedar, into a shanty right across the creek from here, where my great uncle lived there, Bus Wilmore. He was an old time waterman. And when I came back out of service, my little model boats and everything was gone. They floated away, flew away, or whatever.
And you decoys too, right?
Huh?
Your decoys were gone?
I don't understand you.
I said your decoys were gone too?
Gone too. Everything was gone. So I don't know what happened to them. I hope whoever got them, I hope they enjoyed them. I had a yardstick and a hatchet and a buck saw. Mm-hmm. I'd get in the skiff and push around the shore and get blocks of wood, cut it like I wanted it. And every little limb had a good crook into it to make a head out of. I would cut them off too. and made those decoys.
That was before I went into service.
Because, see, that was from about 8 on up. And I built my first boat. Got the lumber out the sawmill. A guy was cutting logs out the woods and picked the boards out. And I built the first one and painted it with tar out of the barrel that my granddad was a fish trapper. Uh-huh. And it was Annual Cookman. They called him Captain Cook. I don't know if you remember him or not. So I built that, and that didn't leak. I do brag on myself for that.
That's pretty good.
And that was the first one. And I walked aside the roads, picked up pop bottles to get money enough to buy nails to build it out.
Yeah, yeah.
And kids nowadays wouldn't even look at a pop bottle. Yeah, yeah. Except drink out.
Can you remember what year that was that you built it?
40s. It in the 40s. That's what it was.
Yeah, yeah. So that was before you were in the Army.
Oh, yeah, that was way before I went in the Army.
Yeah, okay, yeah. So you've been building boats for a long time.
I've been at it a long time.
Yeah.
Then I was building some stuff on my own, and Henry Stevens used to run a railway on Cone River, as known as Cone River Marina now. Mm-hmm. And he asked me to come over and help him out. And I told Mr. Stevens, I said, man, I don't know enough about working on other people's boats. He said, well, you know enough that I see. So I went over there and I went to helping him build and paint, whatever come up. Mm-hmm. And Lake Cat had an old boat called the Estelle. And Mr. Mothershead built that over on the Rappahannock, what I understand. He brought it down and he told Henry, he said, if you don't mind, I'd like to get Francis to work on my boat. He said, okay. And he told me, he said, now you take all the rotten wood over the left side, that's the port side, on that side from the cabin back. Well, he came back later that afternoon. I had tore the whole side of out, half of the stern. It was a round stern. And he come down there and he got out his pickup and hollered, said, hey, Henry, get that man off it. I won't have nothing left. I'll never forget that. And his son today, Lakey, will tell you the same thing. His daddy said so. And I put it all back. I told him, I said, well, you said take all the rotten wood out. And that's what I did.
So, once you start with that, you can go a long way.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Have you ever kept a count of how many boats you made totally?
Last winter, I started it, and it was over 400. Different sizes.
Yeah, yeah.
I was going through some old receipts that I had. Because I went through old income tax papers and stuff like that that I've had since back in the, when I was about 16, 17 years old when I went to work at Walnut Point. Yeah. And so I was going through them. I never did finish it, counting it. I remember I built a skiff for Ernest Spruce. He's dead now. Painted and lumber and labor and all for $150.
Can I commission you? is there one boat in particular that you built that you're really proud of that, you know, just...
Well, in one way, I guess that some has looked a little prettier than others, mm-hmm. but I'm proud of all, and I give God all the thanks. The credit for building this stuff. A lot of people don't do that.
Yeah.
That's the first thing I always do before I start the boat. I ask God for knowledge to get this boat built. Help me through it. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people don't believe in God at all. Yeah. And I'm mighty afraid they're going to be fooled one of these days.
Yeah. Well, he's given you a very special skill.
Uh-huh.
Very special talent.
Yeah. And
but there's no one particular one that's your masterpiece.
Not really. It's one I built for a guy, mm-hmm. and that was 21 inches long. And that's what it was, a little dead rise. I just finished a 21 footer mm-hmm. dead rise. And I think I built that for Paul Haynie. I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. because he's got two of my boats, and I'm almost sure that was the first one.
Yeah.
And Mr. Peck came by, and he wanted me to build him one just like it, 21 inches. That's what it turned out to be. And I built a skiff, a little boat for him, built a rack to put on it, and it's over the bay quarter now, sitting on a mantelpiece. Because he's been dead, his daughter, he had a couple of daughters and all, and they got it.
Did you build that with planks and frames and everything like that? Or
everything.
Just like the
log? All the dead rise cut out in individual pieces and all. And I'm really kind of proud of that because it turned out real good. And I never charged a man a dime for it.
Huh.
And that made me feel much better because he was a nice old fella.
Is that Humphrey Peck? Peck Humphrey? No, Peck. No. Mr. Peck.
Peck.
Yeah.
And he came up one day and said, I got something for you. He had a 20-pound sledgehammer. Was his granddaddy's. He give it to me. He said, I want you to have it. And I still got that.
Yeah. What's the largest boat you ever built?
It was 40, almost 45-foot box stern. She, they tell me that she made the calendar for the year at the museum at Newport News or somewhere. Yeah. Ronnie Dotson, they called him the wild man. That's who ended up with it, the boat.
Why'd they call him the wild man?
He wild.
Oh.
He wild. And Roy Headley, there was out in the bay. I built a boat for my great-nephew, Lenny Rock. And the boy, he couldn't pay for it. So I refunded his money back, and I never appetized it. Roy Headley and his buddy came up and looked at it. Ron and them came up the next day and looked at it. He said, I don't have no money with me now. Can we shake hand on the deal? I said, you got my word on it. So the next day, they was in the bay crabbing. Roy Headley, he calls up him on his radio he had on the boat and tells him, he said, well, said, he used to go after the boat, said, I carried him money yesterday and I bought it. When I got home, Ronnie was sitting here waiting. I said, no. I said, Roy didn't bought no boat. I said, I gave you my word. You came first. And he said, well, I appreciate that. But he said, I got some money today, though. Yeah.
Now, you build your boats out of pine.
Spruce.
Spruce pine.
I built them out of fir, too.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't particularly like fir. Of building boats. Now I've used it for a keel, the Kelson and the Skag and all. And the fur is all right, only the splinter so bad and bust on you.
And you cut your own lumber? You find your own lumber?
I go in the woods and pick out the trees that I like to have, and the property owner give me permission, and I cut it and haul it. And up the road here, about a mile, it was a logger in there, John Dibbins. He did today. And he was cut and had old rosemary trees that I couldn't even get my arms around, halfway around the trees. And I told him what he wanted, and I said, now cut it the long length. And he drug the whole thing out. And Eddie Gaskins come up here with his rig he carries his trap poles on. We put the log on it. And it was 37 feet long. He hauled it down to Andy Cockles, and he's going to saw it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he put it up on the log carriage part before he got on the main carriage.
Yeah.
And the log was so heavy, it broke one end of that down. But we finally got it on the carriage.
Yeah. So you have the sawing actually done over to Andy Cockles then?
Yeah, I had sawing. He done the long logs.
Yeah.
But all the short logs, the man came right here in the yard here, and we sawed it here.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I was lucky to get logs at a Mantraway farm down here. Those trees, spruce pine, run over 100 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful stuff.
Yeah. Now, are there fir trees around here?
It's a few, but not right around here close.
Uh-huh.
But I'd ordered the fir, a lot of it through the Lee & Lumber Company.
Uh-huh.
And they got it out of Baltimore. Then David Schools were working at Lee, and he went to Moore's, and I used to get some stuff from him. He brought a 40-foot 10x12 Kelson here, the truck driver did, on a load of lumber, stuck me over the cab on back, and the driver said, well, David said you would know how to get it off. I said, well, there ain't no problem getting it off. So I tied one end to the tree, and I told him, drive on ahead until that end went down on the ground, and I take the tractor and pick the other end up. Mm-hmm. He said, well, David said you know how to do it.
But all your planking is your spruce pine.
Spruce pine and rosemary pine.
You get from around mm-hmm. here.
Now, it's September going into October, so you ought to be looking around for wood again about this time now.
Oh, they ain't no good to cut. For boat lumber, yeah. It's no good to cut until but the last of November.
Yeah, and that's when the sap is down.
You'll sap it down.
Yeah. Okay, so you'll start cutting in November.
Yeah, but at my age now, I don't think I'm a fool cutting no more.
And then you'll age this wood once it's cut into planks for how long?
Well, see, if you cut it in the winter when the sap down,
yeah.
You put it in air dry, then you have cold weather, freezes it.
Mm-hmm.
Freeze the turpentine right out of it.
Yeah.
Now, oak takes 1 inch per year
mm-hmm.
to dry that.
Yeah.
But if putting it in a kiln dry and drying it, it kills the lumber.
Yeah.
I built boats out of white cedar and been kiln dried. Gilbert Kent, he's dead, but built a 38-foot round stern for him. And taking the lumber, and he carried it up to Montrose and put it in a kiln and brought it back. And you go to bend some of it, would break.
Mm-hmm.
See, it takes a life out of it.
So it's more brittle.
Yeah. See, that's some more man's stuff to draw.
Mm-hmm.
He can't wait until God takes care of it. And your lumber, when you stacking it, like you got it all dry, you want to put it in the shed,
mm-hmm.
take kerosene or diesel fuel and mix it together and put it in a spray and spray all your lumber. That keeps all the drywood worms out of it.
Yeah.
And if you don't cut the bark off the edges of it, what's left, that drywood worm will get into that
mm-hmm.
and mess up that board.
Kerosene and diesel fuel, huh? Wonder who discovered that.
What's that?
The kerosene and diesel fuel combination to spray.
I don't know. I used to use coupon oil.
Uh-huh.
They said that was the greatest stuff to use in the boats. They come out of green and a cloud and another color, and everybody wanted the green. I put it on the boats' washboards. And all, in 2 years' time, it rotted off.
Huh.
And you take any wood and paint it green, it'll rot quicker, and it will be any other color. No, don't ask me why, because I don't know. It just don't last. Laddie Townsend, I built a boat for him. It was 29-footer. I built a skiff, and I had 4 boards come out of that log. I put 2 of them on his boat for washboards. I built the skiff sides out of the other. About 5 years, the washboards had rotted right off of. So I put all new top work, used the coupon oil on it. The skiff only used linseed oil and turpentine. Now diesel fuel's good. Any kind of oil will soak in your wood,
yeah.
And then it'll let your lumber breathe on one side.
But that doesn't prolong the drying process, though? Because you're putting oils back into the wood.
No, your lumber's already dry.
Oh, okay.
That's if you build it.
Yeah. Oh, okay, after you built it, yeah.
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 And that's all I've been using for God knows how many years. We used it over the railway when I first went to work over there,
mm-hmm.
putting linseed oil and turpentine. You just mix it, guess at it, half and half,
yeah.
And mix it up. We used to put it in with a brush. Then we saved money enough up to buy a spray. Then you had to clean the nozzle every time you used it. so it's much easier to use the brush.
Yeah. And your oak you cut from around here.
Yeah, all white oak. Yeah. Chestnut oak or red oak is no good for a boat. I've known some guys to put chestnut oak in boats, and that will rot. And you always want to get your oak with the sap down.
Yeah.
I've got oak out there in the shed now. It's 12 or 14 inches and 20 foot long, 2 inches thick. I use that for the skeg, the shoeing on a flat bottom skiff. Some don't put but a 1x6 down the bottom. I want to put something strong enough they don't get that belly into it.
Have you got any orders for boats now?
Right now, I don't.
Yeah.
See, having that stroke over a year ago, it knocked me back.
Yeah.
And I had people that wanted me to build boats, but I just couldn't do it at the time. Mm-hmm. And I've got the lumber to do it. Good stuff.
Yeah. Have you noticed that, because the economy's not as good as it was a couple of years ago, have you noticed that business has dropped off? You're getting fewer requests for...
Well, the market is gone to nothing.
Yeah.
Because anybody got money to not spend it.
Right.
I had one leave here this week. It was almost a 17-foot flat-bottom skiff. I guess you saw it.
Is that the new one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's gone up in 20 miles of Pennsylvania line. I can't remember the exact little spot he went to or nothing like that.
Yeah.
But he took that away from me a day before yesterday.
Tell him about the skiff that went, the two boats that went to England.
Yeah, that was a guy that flew a big transport. Now, I didn't see him or nothing like that, but I built him for him. He said he carried him over there.
Yeah.
And, of course, he's gone. And he said he carried it over to his place over there, and his next-door neighbor liked it, so he sold it to him, and I built another one for him.
How long ago was that?
Oh, that's been 20 years ago, I guess.
20 years ago?
Uh-huh.
Is that the furthest away you built the boat for somebody for?
Huh?
Is that the furthest point away that you built, you've had somebody?
Yeah,
Now,
he said he carried him over there. I'm just going by his word,
Mm-hmm. Was he in the Air Force or anything like that?
He flew, he was in the Air Force.
Okay.
What's the smallest rowing skiff that you think is workable, flat-bottom rowing skiff?
Well, I built one for a lady 8 foot long and put a little tank into it, and she was staying inside and push it around instead of get up on the bow of it.
Uh-huh.
And she had that very many years. That went up to Coles Point. That was Boots's, my brother's wife, a second wife, I guess it would put it. And I don't know whatever come of it or nothing like that.
Did it row reasonably well?
Oh, yeah, it rowed real good. She was tickling there. Mm-hmm. I cut the stern up a little bit more than I generally, for a rowing skiff.
Uh-huh.
8 foot.
Mm-hmm.
That was another thank you job. Good appetizing, I guess.
Yeah, a little public relations.
And I ain't never appetized a boat yet, except one. And I did put that in a Rappahannock rocket. That's the round stern.
Mm-hmm.
I've had people been here looking at it, but nobody seemed to want to take a boat built for fish trapping and for anything else.
Yeah. You never built one for the museum, have you?
They
no.
They had one of your skiffs there.
Okay. Yeah.
They got one a roundabout way.
Yeah.
Yeah, not directly, though.
Uh-oh. Just like I said, I'm a jackleg, and the museum don't want jackleg stuff direct, straight through.
Oh,
they would have come around in a circle.
Yeah. I'm a little slow sometimes, so
yeah.
Be patient. Yeah.
I know that two of your boats, Paul always keeps two boats, doesn't he?
Yeah. Yeah, I've got them all. I've got boats all down to Louisiana, Texas. I guess it's still down in Texas or Louisiana. It may be blown away by now.
Where does Paul live?
He lives in Fairport.
Fairport.
And Fish is out of Fairport.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, he's got those two 20-some foot
boat.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, keep them down, tied up down there, the old fish.
He told me they had never leaked it since he's owned them. I told him I could come down and fix that too. And yes. George Rue, he lives out of Burgess. He's got one that's 34 foot. And he's got built it with an inboard outboard. Then he had it changed a few years ago and put an inboard in it.
Got a V drive in
it. Yeah, got a V drive.
Yeah, I see your, that's your brother, Paul?
Cousin.
I see him from my house down there as he comes up to sell his crabs to Ronnie.
He and his father didn't know but one speed, and that's wide open.
Yeah. Wide open.
Right.
Yeah, those are handsome boats.
Oh, yeah.
I built one from, what's the other Haynie boy? You know something I can't? Tommy Haynie.
Okay.
And he'd go across the bay everywhere. We left, I was living on the other side of the creek over at Pine Point at the time when I built that one. And then we put a red old board, had two drain plugs wide open, and putting hot grease and stuff in the seams, keep them sinking, and carried it down the bay. And I told him, I said, well, he was going to Roy Headless up in there. I said, Tommy, don't open this thing up because too much pressure blowing the stuff out the seam. No, I ain't going to run open. Just as soon as he got in sight, opened the motor wide open. That thing was flying. What a squirting up going 10 feet an hour over top of the boat. Yeah.
Your name is Sunrise.
Yeah. And he'd up and sold the boat.
Yeah.
Then he bought it back.
Yeah. This creek, was the mouth of this creek open when you moved here or when you were young?
Yeah, we had a narrow channel coming in.
Uh-huh.
On your right, Bay Quarter Shores, it was Bay Quarter, they called it.
Uh-huh.
It's a piece of property, years and years. That came almost across the creek on one side. And Great Neck, it belongs to part of Warren Point now, that came down almost passing one another. And I've heard my granddaddy say when they used to come in sailboats, could take a 10-foot boat hook and touch the bank on either side and run it in with 10 to 20 feet of water in the creek. Then over the years, when I went in service back in 1950, Bay Quarter had a Long Island came down there. When I came back, most of that washed away. Because the brain people come down, told them to cut all the trees down. Bullnose it, and the sea would come up on it and wash back. Well, the people developed it, they'd done what they said. It washed back, took the land right with them.
So how much water is out there now in the mouth?
Well, on ordinary tide, regular high tide, you got maybe 3.5-4 feet. And when you get a heavy northwester for 2-3 days, the tide goes down, the seagulls can walk all across it.
And there's no particular channel in there anymore?
No, all about the same thing.
It's just about the same.
We got a place marked off, everybody runs in there.
Mm-hmm. That's the same situation with Hull Creek. Yeah,
that's right, Hull Creek the same way, and Presses Creek.
Yeah.
Well, my wife and myself, we used to build bulkheads, piers, worked on boats, and crabs. Shedded crabs. And have we done it all? I don't have no idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
We were young on one thing.
Well, yeah. A little while ago I asked you about what were impressions of how things were here during the Depression.
Uh-huh.
Do you know anything or have any sense of how it was here during World War II?
During that, I do remember some of that.
Mm-hmm.
I remembered the Potomac River would be froze from one side to the other, and the ships, you could in the Potomac, you could hear them busting the ice and all. Mm-hmm. And I think I was about 14 years old at the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I remember them, and I remember gasoline was 11 cents a gallon.
Yeah.
And a lot of people wouldn't believe that today, but I do remember that.
With your ration ticket.
Yeah.
During the ABC. And then we got the tickets, coupons for that. And I've got some, I still got some of them somewhere. I got to hunt them things up. Because mm-hmm. Grayson Smith said, if you got them, I like to have them.
Yeah, I'm sure.
He auctioned them off.
Yeah.
Wendell said, you and your brother were walking around the shore one day on a Chesapeake and found something.
Yeah.
What was it?
We were living down there in the old house down there past Slaughter's Beach. And we were walking up the shoreline, and that was up there almost to Blackberry Hang.
Yeah.
It's Taylor's, the Taylor's Beach it is now. And happened looking, that was a body on the ground, on the washed up in the treetop. He had come off a fishing steamer, a black guy. Mm-hmm. And we came back and told my dad, and then the law went down there and all that. And it was $1,000 reward for that person. Hmm. We never got no money for it.
Was he a fugitive from justice or something?
Huh?
Was he a fugitive from justice or something? You said there was a reward for him.
Yeah, well, they had a reward for the body.
Oh, okay.
That's what I meant.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And they had been looking for him. And so we never took the money because we didn't have sense enough to know what $1,000 was then.
Something then, too.
Oh, yeah. And so the family needed money worse than we needed, I guess.
Yeah.
But he had swelled up, I mean, three times as big as we didn't know what it was when we first saw it. We didn't stay around there very long. We came back in a hurry. That's been a long time ago.
Yeah.
I wouldn't know, probably six, seven years old at the time.
Did the Navy fly some seaplanes down in that area?
I don't know.
Land or something. I saw an aeronautical chart one time that had that right off of Taylor's Beach, designated as a seaplane landing spot.
It might have been
there. They did there. They had the Naval Amphibious Training Base at Solomons, Maryland.
Solomons, yeah.
And they would bring the landing barges and land them down there.
Uh-huh.
And one of them had a winch to raise the bow up. And slipped out the guy's hand and busted him right in the head. And I remember they had him up at Mr. Hammock's store. And we run down there and looked at him.
I know one time I was down there staying with my daddy then before I moved back with my grandparents. It was some people over to Reedville, a young couple, came in and had a big cedar tree there. And they put their blanket out on the ground, they got their food out and everything, and have a little picnic. Mm-hmm. Well, we had a billy goat, and they didn't see the billy goat. He run them both in the back in the car, and he had a meal of his own. I'll never forget that. I was young. Yeah.
In your interview with Chowning, you talk about a Mr. Battleson.
Yeah.
Tell us something about him.
Mr. Jim Balson.
Yeah.
That's who that was in that. Well, he got his story right because he was taping it. Who helped him didn't get it right. They got it in there where I was living here. I'd go across the creek. That wasn't so. I've told him, but I think he got it corrected. I was living across the creek with my granddaddy, and I would walk through the woods over to Pine Point as it is today. And he was building a boat for his son, Bernard Balson, and Bernard was helping him some, a diamond stern boat. and he wouldn't let me get in 20 feet of anything. I sit out there and watch him build the stuff. Only the time he would let me get close to hold something for him. And that I was right there. And he had tools that he could shave with them. And he cut everything by hand, chopped it with a hatchet or edge. And I picked up Ray Smarter stuff from watching him. And he made a thing out of locust, four wheels and connecting rod thing and all. And once he turned it, it kept right on working. And he was going to have a patent of it, and he died before he could get it. So he had two sons. They taken it to Washington to get the patent. And if it went up there and told the truth about it, it would have been all right. But they didn't. They said they built it. And I know better than that. Of course, they all dead too now. And so it didn't get no patent. And far as I know, it's still in the museum in Washington. Mm-hmm. That was a pretty piece of stuff.
Yeah.
What was it for?
What do you call it? Pepsi Motion or something like that? Oh,
perpetual motion?
Yeah.
Machine, yeah.
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 And that thing, he'd start, and that thing would keep working.
Huh. All out of locust.
Huh?
All made out of locust.
Locust. And he had it bounce so the wheels would keep turning all the time.
Uh-huh. Huh.
He was a nice old fellow.
Yeah. But you say it's up at the Smithsonian in Washington?
Yeah, as far as I know, that's where they took it up at. They kept it up at.
Uh-huh.
They got a little money, it wasn't much.
Yeah. But he never got the patent?
No, never got no patent for it because they didn't build it. The vet went on and said, my daddy built it and stuff like that. Maybe it's been different.
Yeah. When did you start using electric tools versus hand tools?
Well, that was back in, I'll say, let me see, 56, 7, along like that. We got current in the house we were living in. Everything was done by hand.
And your first tools that you got were what? First electric tools.
First electric tool, I got some Sarah Roebuck stuff. And they weren't worth bringing down the road. I mean, for my work now. They weren't made for commercial use.
Uh-huh.
And so then I turned around and got Skill and old Milwaukee tools. Mm-hmm. And they hold up. That's commercial stuff.
Say that you didn't really have any until they brought current in here, electric current, right?
Not this house.
Yeah.
We were living in an old house up here just before you get to Smithland Church on the left back in the field.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been gone. They tore it all down. The farmer's dead. And,
yeah.
And all.
Yeah. About what year did they bring the electricity in? Remember?
I know I would say we built a house down on Hull Creek in 48, and there was power in that, electricity in that right from the beginning.
Uh-huh. No, we didn't have none in that. That was the old Dawson home. And that house was built out of round pine put together with locust pegs.
Oh.
That's how old it was. And it didn't have 2x6s or 2x4s for rafters. It had skint pines, round pines, for the rafters.
What shape was it in when they tore it down?
It was in livable shape.
That's too bad, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What an artifact that would be.
Yeah, and that house was well over 100 years old. Had to be. They had blacksmith nails the house was put together with.
Uh-huh.
It was this old piece of iron beat out,
yeah.
Made in nails.
What kind of fastenings do you use in your boats now?
I use a galvanized, a rose head boat nail.
Uh-huh.
Able, one place I know you can get them at, and that's up in, I can't think of the name of that place now, a Rhode Island.
Jamestown?
Jamestown, uh-huh. They have them. And because they use those, they will hold better into their boats they build than a stainless or vinyl. Because the sea is the paneling, pops the heads off the nails. Mm-hmm. So a rose head nail, once you set it up, the more you set it, the tighter the lumber gets together. It pulls it together. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I bought a 600 pounds one time. I asked Lee Lumber Company about it. Paxton, and he said, "Well, we're not going to stock them no more because we're not selling too many." But I said, "I know where you can get it in a place in West Virginia where they're still made in there." And I called him. Said, "Yeah." And I said, "How much you like to have?" I said, 100 pounds." Said, "We don't sell them no less than 600 pounds, 500 or 600." So I give him the order what I wanted. They sent it right here by the freight truck.
Did it really?
Yeah.
It lasted you for a while, I guess.
I still got some of them.
Uh-huh.
Then Dave Bradley, you know him.
Yeah.
He went to some auction, and he come back with a whole pallet of nails. Some of them 8-inch long.
Is that right?
Big ones.
Yeah.
And, of course, I used some of those in building piers and bulkheads. Mm-hmm. A little harder to drive, but you use a bigger hammer.
Well, you use that 20-pound sledgehammer on it.
Yeah.
What do you use a 20-pound sledge for?
For holding behind it, the knees when I'm setting the nails up and stuff like that.
Don't swing it.
And I've got a number of those, 50 pounds.
Really?
Wow. Uh-huh.
I'm particularly interested in how you get your boats from the shop down to the end of the water.
That's no problem.
I see your carts out there and so forth.
I got a big trailer out there.
Yeah.
And you all notice that fiberglass boat up in the field as you come in on your left?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's 32 foot, and a man wanted to get it out. And she'd been in the water for 2 years, had barnacles on the size of hen eggs. And I said, "Well, put it on the trailer. I'll put it in the field. Y'all take it off." So I just backed the trailer in the water and floated on, went on up there and backed it up where he wanted that, and they jacked it up.
Mm-hmm.
That boat is heavy now.
Yeah.
She's got two Chrysler Marine engines into it, and they had 500 pounds of barnacles and stuff on the bottom of it.
Okay.
Yeah, we got married in 53, December the 19th. And it'll soon be 55 years.
Yeah.
Same woman.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think I could have found anybody, nobody, if I searched the whole world over. And I always tease her that she come from Quinton Oak, and she said, "That's on the opposite side of the road." And
oh, yeah.
So what was your maiden name?
She was a Wilkins.
Wilkins.
Yeah. And she went to Mary Washington College and got 4 years of English. Speak up.
CA degree.
Yeah. And I told Dr. James, Watson James III, he dead now. I said, "Well, she got all the education." He said, "Well, it takes a positive and a negative to work." So that's what we are.
Opposites attract.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Well, you're very lucky.
Yeah.
Very lucky. Very good.
And I hope we get 50 more, but I don't think it's going to happen. Never know.
Yeah. Never know.
What year did you graduate from Mary Washington?
53. Mm-hmm.
She graduated, then we got married.
Okay. Well, as far as winding up the interview portion, thank you very much. It's been great.
Well, I'm glad I could tell you what it is, you know, going on.
He would have lived if he hadn't shot himself. A few scraps.
Okay.
My problem is I can't remember where things are, though.
Me either. I can't remember half the stuff.
And how old are you, how long do you think this boat is?
It's 32. Overall.
It looks large in here.
I know it does. But it'll drop 10 feet when you put it overboard. It don't do it, but that's what happened.
Tell us about this seam, Francis.
The seam, what I generally do before I start the caulking, I take a squirt can with burnt oil, and I'll go down the seam and make the cotton go in easier, and it don't stick to your caulking iron. Then, after you get through caulking that seam out, you take the same squirt can with oil and go right down over the seam, over the cotton. Mm-hmm. Well, that soaks in the cotton and reserves the cotton. And 50 years from now, that cotton will still be good. Then now your paint go on that.
Yeah.
I got sand all this yet.
And this is to keep the boat well fit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I noticed a couple of those around there.
See, they come in here and work on at night, and I keep food there for them. And this stern is white oak, 2 inches thick, and it's only two boards.
Well, that's a beautiful. Are you going to use some shoe polish on this?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Did you get that?
You can take it and sand it down. And shoe polish is good to stain wood with.
Yeah. Makes it look like mahogany, right?
You can make it look mahogany any color you want, you know.
Yeah.
The boat that, let's see, which one of those that? One of those boats. Paul Haynie. He had a big boat. And he wanted a stern varnish. Mr. Seals?
Anybody doing this for?
No, this is anybody wants it. I started this before I had the stroke. The last February, over a year ago, I had the lumber and everything. I didn't have to buy nothing. So I decided to go ahead and build the boat. And I started. Then I got busy pulling in the hauling. And I didn't get back to it. And then I had the damn stroke.
About what would you get for this boat finished?
Finished with engine or what?
Without an engine, say.
Probably about 18 pounds, something like that. Because she's got all the hardware down there, all fastened into it.
Engine would run another, what, 8, 10,000?
8, 10. Depends on what kind of motor you get. Now, if you get a diesel, you better figure a little more, a whole lot more. But so many people, they're going back to gas.
Oh, they've
got a fuel injected engine, and it burns a whole lot less gas. This ethanol they got in the gas is hard on carburetors.
Hard on everything.
Any questions you want to hear about this here, I can tell you as you go along.
You do this all by eye. Right?
Yeah. Only thing you use a level is to get your scalp with your bottom up, get this both sides level. Mm-hmm. And the stem, you get that straight up and down. Or, you know, on your angle, whatever you want. Yeah. Use the level for that. Then you hang your level up.
Down here?
You don't need that.
Mm-hmm.
This is a one-piece stem. Inside and outside, all in one piece. And it comes on down into here.
Yeah.
Where your skag comes up, right here. That's a stop water right there.
Mm-hmm.
All right. This is cut out, or rabbited it out, and goes right on back, and then it comes out to nothing.
Yeah.
This here is part of the kelson right there, inside piece, where the skeg is at.
Mm-hmm.
I do all my boats like that.
Yeah, things like this are a work of art.
Huh?
These are a work of art.
No, that's jackleg stuff.
Well, I know. That's where you're coming from. But
Ray Rogers, you know him?
Oh, I know Ray, yeah.
He's been over here and took it, measured it, it boat up.
Uh-huh.
Every inch of it.
Yeah.
He says he's going to build a model. You can get a computer and we'll cut all the dead water for you.
Mm-hmm.
I said, yeah, you get it and I want to see it work. Then if it works, I'll buy it.
Yeah.
And man, they didn't short with it.
Yeah.
No. Every piece of deadwood changes angle.
Mm-hmm.
A different twist.
Yeah.
No, I'm not sand all this down, it'll all be slick.
Mm-hmm. I can see it, but it's just...
You know, I had boards here, I could put this all in spruce.
Mm-hmm.
But I couldn't make myself cut a 22-foot board in two.
Yeah.
So I had the salt treated, was good and dry, so I put that on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It ain't supposed to rot, they say.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, this is beautiful.
And on this hole right here, that's where your cabin
mm-hmm.
comes right there and goes up on the decking.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
And I'll put bunks in it and all. I got one down to the creek there in the boathouse, but it's all finished.
Yeah.
I built that for a guy. And this here is what you call an anchor's place. Mm-hmm. See, it comes up here, goes on up here like that.
Mm-hmm.
See, it comes up. That's what you call an anchor splice.
Yeah.
And that will hold.
Mm-hmm. An anchor splice, yeah.
And it's got bolts coming up through here, mm-hmm. brass bolts between mm-hmm. them. And plus it's fastened to the knees
mm-hmm.
and stop water in here. See, when you join something together, you got to put a stop water in.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
It'll leak a flood. I done all the hardware and shaft hole and everything mm-hmm. before I even put the knees in the sides of it. I could walk around, stand, and work. When I got ready to caulk this boat before I turned her over,
mm-hmm.
I didn't have strength enough in my hand to hold that mallet. And I asked God, would he give me strength at his will, not my will,
mm-hmm.
and it looked like an automatic jump right in my hand just like that.
Yeah.
And I got a friend that was over here. He said, I wouldn't believe it if I hadn't seen it myself. And that was old man Joe Haynie.
I don't know Joe Haynie.
He's talking about it.
Your grandfather.
You remember him, though?
Just barely.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew where he lived.
Yeah. Old man Joe, that was my granddad. My great. I bought that thing at an auction. And the auctioneer, she didn't know what the devil she was selling.
Wow. That's 1700s vintage, huh?
See the metal been put together?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I sprayed some paint on it after I cleaned it up, so.
Mm-hmm.
See, they brought the metal over and beat it out and together.
Yeah.
That's something.
That is.
It was in the late 1600, early 1700.
Mm-hmm.
And got some broad hatches there.
Mm-hmm.
And I use them sometimes. Sometimes I don't use them. Now I don't use hardly anything.
Oh, they gone. That's some of them.
Oh, they're like a cutting nail, aren't they?
Yeah, but it's a rose head because it hit it round on it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Fresh,
eh? Yeah, squared.
See, that nail will hold. When you put the spike punch on it and set it up, it pulls the lumber together closer
mm-hmm.
as you go along.
very similar look like this right now.
Yeah.
Did you build that?
No.
Cause I saw
I put a pile hoof and all.
I saw it down Reedville over here.
Yeah, it's got dead rise here, flat bottom skiff. That's the way. Yeah, George, you're building one. This looks like this. Yeah, except it's a dead rise all the way back. No, it isn't. It's a flat. Well, there's the dead rise back here. Right there. So where does the dead rise start? Right here. Yeah, right there on both here. Yeah. See, I cut my boards up at the front, come back, and that to give that cheek out. When you come ahead, you come right up.
Mm-hmm.
Don't plow down by the bow.
And that big boat there, she's
soon to sail.
9 years old.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
How fast will she go?
Huh?
How fast will she go?
She'll come out of the water back to the cabin. Back in the cabin. She's got a 2 reduction, 2.0 transmission on it, and it's a V6. And I've got the top all made up, put on. And it's been a whole summer, ain't got that on there yet.
Yeah. Do you use it, did it?
I'd get into it and ride down it, out the river a little bit and come back. You can turn the pump on, all you've got covered out the other end is out. This one here, 22,500. And we built this in April, last of April.
You were coming.
The doctor told me to do anything I felt like doing, and I felt like doing it.
That was this boathouse that you built.
Uh-huh.
That was this boathouse here that you built, yeah.
Yeah, we built that.
Yeah.
A wife myself. Of course, I had a pile driver, and I didn't have to lift in on anything.
Mm-hmm.
I'd hoist the rafters up, the trusses, and then we'd float it right in place and
mm-hmm.
slack them down, fasten it.
Yeah.
But I think all them days is over with now.
The voice of an angel breathing a lesson unheard. Oh, for the gentle persuasion whispers her comforting. Darkness is over. Wait till the tempest is done. Hope for sunshine tomorrow after the shower is gone. Come glad fruition. that weary heart. Come, O thou blessed hope to glory. Never, oh never depart.